economic and political liberty of etc etc, and then we come to equality. And in equality it says equality of status and of opportunity. Very, very clearly, we need to understand what the status and opportunity is, and to promote among them all fraternity, etc., etc. So what is this status? What is this opportunity? Friends, let us be proud of our constitution, which has provided us this. Oh my goodness. Ajuel,
sir,
I need. Yeah, I got it. We need to understand what the status and opportunity is. Friends, the general understanding is all men and women are equal. But I would say the spirit of the Constitution tilts towards people in this country who have not been able to enjoy equality to the fullest, who have prevented equality. And from a human rights perspective, this is what we should be able to understand from this preamble portion of the right equality, explained as equality of status and equality of opportunity and of opportunity. We believe that this equality will never come if we don't give those who did not have the chances in life to enjoy that equality an opportunity to enjoy that equality. The Constitution has to provide those opportunities for those lesser privileged to be able to enjoy that equality. Left by itself, you will find that women never had the opportunity to enjoy equality. And therefore, the Constitution says, if you want women to enjoy equality, then make sure that you provide them a special opportunity to enjoy equality. Otherwise, this will be the pulpit sermon of a priest on a Sunday mass. And so therefore, this opportunity that is mentioned in the preamble is the opportunity that articles 15 and 16 provide through what we commonly call as reservations. We provide this special opportunity that people who never enjoyed equality throughout history will now be able to enjoy equality. And therefore, equality will be true. Equality will be somewhere where everybody is actually equal. And it is not just the principle of equality being there. Women, I told you, you all understand. Let us proceed. We are born in a caste society. And I want to recall what Justice Anand Venkatesh said in the election. Very rightly said, the mother of most human rights violations in this country is this caste system that we have. And insisted that we should be able to fight against this caste system, not only through laws, but also a lot of awareness. You would see in the newspapers that even during the day of the pandemic, the COVID-19, the amount of cases against people belonging to the scheduled castes and the scheduled tribes is increasing in the country even today. Caste discrimination and untouchability practices were visible during the tsunami periods, during cyclones, etc. And therefore, if you want to ensure that every member of the scheduled caste community and the scheduled tribe community and the so-called backward caste community and the most backward caste community enjoy equality, our constitution says, then ensure that they are provided an opportunity in the Constitution. So equality is status and of opportunity, and that opportunity is what we call as reservation in the Constitution. And this is very, very important. I know reservation is a topic which is very, very, very touchy. It's extremely touchy because that you see in your own class somebody being benefited and somebody not being benefited. And we always have to remind ourselves that there was a historical injustice done to a few. And if that historical injustice was not rectified by veterans who started exclusive colleges for women, like you have teachers in this audience from the famous Lady Doak College of Madurai, if your your founder, Cox, if she had not initiated this exclusive women's college, then the number of women in Madurai who would have had access to college education would have been extremely poor. You can talk about other exclusive women's colleges as well. And therefore, you see that providing them this opportunity, you will be able to give them an opportunity of being on par with men, and because they would have access to education. But this is okay in a private institution. You have to give these opportunities at different levels within the government in terms of employment and in terms of education if you want to attain equality. This is what we are aiming at in terms of right to equality. Two, in terms of promotions, in terms of opportunities, also look at caste. Imagine people within communities where you don't have access. I remember a colleague of mine who was working with me here. Those who know me, those who know her, would definitely know who the person is. An excellent girl, a brilliant girl. Her English was impeccable. She was a staff. She left us to join a particular university. And she went to that university. And when she went to the university, she found that she was entitled, that there was an opening for a position of teacher in a particular department. She applied for the job because she was a member of the Dalit community, but a member of the Arundhatiyar community in Tamil Nadu, which has a special reservation within the SC reservation. There was no doubt she would get it. There was just no doubt she would get it. But then she was told that the going rate at that point of time was 17 lakhs. Most of you here are people perhaps in private colleges. But these days, private Christian colleges also have going rates. I come from a city where sometimes I have to put my head down because we hear of Christian colleges with rates. But anyhow, this university had a growing rate, and by no chance she could get it. She made immediately a letter to the then authorities. I don't even want to give any hint, so I just say authorities in the ministry. And the very next day, on the date of the interview, there was a call to the vice chancellor saying, "We understand that there is a candidate from this community, and please ensure if there is no other competing candidate that she is appointed." And this was on her own. And today she is a professor, and today she has moved on to a central university as well. That was reservation. And because of reservation, you are able to see that somebody who otherwise was equal or much better than others was able to get through because of the historicity of the exclusion that Dalits, tribals, backward class have suffered. It's very difficult for others to accept, but it's a fact that we will definitely have to put up with. That is what our constitution has brought in. So this equality of status and opportunity is what is the basis. We will then go. This is the Article 14 of the Constitution, which you will read, and it reads equality. The state shall not deny any person equality before the law, and the equal protection of the laws within the territory. Now, this is what equality is. But because of that, there are two things that come into play. One, therefore, we should prohibit discrimination. If you want equality, you should prohibit discrimination. And not only prohibit discrimination, you should also be able to ensure that you have special provisions provided for people who need special provisions in employment and education. So there are two ways of looking at this. One is to ensure that there is no discrimination, and the law reads very clearly, the state shall not discriminate on the basis of what? On grounds only of religion, race, caste, sex, place of birth, or any of them. Or no citizen shall, on grounds only of religion, once again, race, caste, sex, place of birth, or any of them, be subject to any disability, any liability, any restriction or condition. Friends, this is very, very clear. Therefore, that this has to be a country with no discrimination. So our equality, our right to equality says non-discrimination. And our right to equality, in addition to saying non-discrimination, also says positive discrimination is allowed. So you will not discriminate, definitely positively discriminate, to ensure that in our primary schools, teachers will be given an opportunity vis-a-vis male teachers. Women teachers will be given. Only then you will find that women teachers will occupy seats. You will find that in various other positions, and that is why you have this whole demand of 33% reservation in parliament, which is not being realized now, past over 12, 13, 14 years. And therefore, this positive discrimination is a means that we have developed, on one hand to see that we don't discriminate, but on the other hand to see that the equality that we are talking about, for that equality to become real, then you need to positively discriminate, so that people who have suffered because of caste benefit, people who have suffered because of gender benefit, and today it has been expanded, people who are discriminated on the basis of their disability also benefit, and people who are persons who belong to the transgenders also benefit, because that is positive discrimination that is showed. Now, on all these grounds of discrimination and positive discrimination, in order that we are able to proceed further, you will see that in the classes that start tomorrow, you will have special laws that relate to persons with disabilities. There are special laws that relate to transgender persons, and which is being also cited here today. So this is our non-discrimination, which I spoke to you about. The concept of opportunity provided as special provisions for women and children. And therefore, in order to ensure that women and children are provided opportunities, there are special provision, and these are positive discrimination that are permitted. Special provisions are also provided for the advancement of institutionally backward classes of citizens, for scheduled caste, scheduled tribes. And Article 16 is the same. This is what I spoke to you about, the positive discrimination. Persons with disabilities enjoy this positive discrimination as well. Transgender persons also enjoy the same, with reservations also for Arundhatiyar communities in Tamil Nadu, as we all know about. The Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act clearly provides for these provisions. So here is the Constitution. And because the Constitution has said so, then you have what is known as the Disabilities Act, and you have the same with the transgender persons, with the new legislation that is in place, which all movements working among the transgenders are not proud of today, the Transgender Persons Protection of Right Act of 2019. But let us not forget one thing, that in the 2014 judgment, which you see on the top of the screen, in National Legal Services Authority versus Union of India, this judgment of the Supreme Court for the first time recognized the rights of the transgender persons in India and laid down a series of measures for securing their rights. If that had to be done, See, who moved the court? The court was not moved by an NGO. The court was not moved by anybody else. The court was moved by none other than the National Legal Services Authority. And I will come back to this later. I'm pointing it out already now. Today, we don't see the National Legal Services Authority finding one single PIL in the Supreme Court during the pandemic. Single has been filed as regards the pandemic in the Madras High Court or the Mumbai High Court or the Kolkata High Court or the Karnataka bench or the Rajasthan bench or the Gawati bench. But here is an example, a positive example of the National Legal Services Authority, which took the cause of the transgender people. And although it is National Legal Services Authority, they filed a case against the Union of India and won the case. And that is the very, very celebrated case where the rights of the transgender persons in India and this judgment delivered, laid down series of measures for securing the rights by mandating prohibition of discrimination of the transgenders, recommending the creation of welfare policies and reservations for transgender persons in education institutions and jobs. Therefore, friends, in terms of equality, all those who suffer from a lack of opportunity to enjoy this equality that our Constitution talks of are provided an opportunity through the mechanism of reservation that we have, which is the tool of positive discrimination to ensure that they are positively discriminated to ensure that they are able to enjoy these rights to equality that we talk in our Constitution. This is the first part, and there's the last part, which I'll finish in a minute, because this, I don't think, needs too much of... The last part of this equality is the abolition of untouchability. I made a mention earlier, but all of you with your experiences around the country will be able to teach me the fact that the practice of untouchability continues. The practices of untouchability continues on our campuses. You had Dr. Vasanthi Devi yesterday quoting from Rohit Vemula. The campuses in JNU, the campuses in various campuses, various universities exhibit caste discrimination. Exhibit caste discrimination. Our colleges have caste discrimination. Definitely have caste discrimination. The only problem is our eyes don't see it, or we don't have mechanisms which are able to reveal that. And our country in the year 19, although the Constitution was 1950, it took us 5 years to bring the Protection of Civil Rights Act. We did not succeed to stop this practice of untouchability. We brought the SCST Prevention of Atrocities Act of 1989. Untouchability did not stop. The same act was amended in the year 2015. And I have the honor of being one of the many people who worked towards the passage of this new law of 2015. And therefore, yesterday we saw right to life includes right to education, right to health, right to housing, right not to be tortured, right to livelihood, etc., etc. We saw what right to liberty is. None of the right to equality means no discrimination. That's number one. Wherever you find that discrimination is continuing, there is a violation of this right to equality. That's number one. Wherever you feel that this opportunity through reservation has been actually stopped to somebody, somebody is not able to access this opportunity, this reservation, that is a violation of right to equality in this country. And the third, wherever there is untouchability, there is a violation of right to equality. So right to equality is a very powerful, powerful weapon in our hands. And this right to equality, in my humble opinion, is not used so much in cases before of human rights violation before the fora that are supposed to take up these violations. But still, it's a very powerful definition. Right to equality is non-discrimination. Right to equality is no denial and reservations. Right to equality is untouchability cannot continue. I repeat, right to equality means no discrimination on all the grounds that we mentioned. Right to equality means there is no preventing people from accessing reservations or the opportunities we speak of, Number three, that there is no practice of untouchability anywhere. I will take a break here. I will look for one or two questions now, and then we will move to the last limb, which is the dignity of the individual.
Okay. Thank you, Andre. Can you hear me? So to summarize, there were a lot of questions, but most of them pertain to the issue of reservations, which we had agreed we will not go into the discussion on reservation at the moment. And I've asked them to park the question when the appropriate session comes. There are three relevant issues which participants want clarification. One I'll ask Rajvel to say because it came in Tamil. The two issues which I am bringing it forward for you for more clarification is that if there is prohibition of discrimination on several grounds and then there's right to equality, why do the governments and several other institutions lay emphasis on caste and religion in all official documents, which also includes Aadhaar and other ID cards? The second question, and if you can elaborate a bit more, is that is the Sabarimala judgment of the Supreme Court was based on the grounds of right to equality, Article 14 of the Indian Constitution, or it was also on the prohibition of discrimination on grounds of sex? So these are two specific questions which came to me. There were also a couple of people who have commented with regard to, okay, it is there in the Constitution, it is fundamental right, but the reality is very different. What we can do, why there is such a big gap. Rajvel, if you can ask the question which came in Tamil.
Sure. Thanks, Matthew. So I'll read out a question in Tamil and apologies for it. I request Henry to translate it and also answer the question. And so it says, அரசியல் உரிமைகளின்படி அனைவரும் சமம் என்ற போதிலும் இந்தியாவில் தண்டனை முறை அனைவருக்கும் சமம் என்பது இன்று வரை சாத்தியமான ஒன்றா? தலைவரின் உயிர் என்றால் அதற்கு மதிப்பு அதிகமா? ஏழு பேருக்கு தண்டனை காலம் முடிந்த பின்பும் விடுதலை செய்ய மறுப்பது ஏன்? So I believe this question is in the context of equality before law.
தமிழ்ல மறுபடியும் சொல்லுங்க.
அரசியல் அனைவரும் சமம் என்ற போதிலும் இந்தியாவில் தண்டனை முறை அனைவருக்கும் சமம் என்பது இது இன்று வரை சாத்தியமான ஒன்றா? தலைவரின் உயிர் என்றால் அதற்கு மதிப்பு அதிகமா? ஏழு பேருக்கு தண்டனை காலம் முடிந்த பின்பும் விடுதலை செய்ய மறுப்பது ஏன்?
Okay, I've also got, thank you for this. I've also got the question sent to me in Tamil. Okay. Where do we start? Friends, first on the question of reservations. Reservations, I'm consciously getting out of this debate on reservations for the simple reason that this session will then refocus on something which we are not supposed to get into, because we are looking at the definition of human rights. And the definition of human rights talks about rights violations through right to life, right to equality, right to liberty, and right to the dignity of the individual as contained in the Constitution. And if these violations take place, then they are human rights violations also. That's number one. That's number one. Now, the nitty-gritties of reservations are matters that will never be brought before a human rights commission or a state human rights commission, because it will be the courts that will determine. So that's for courts. But we should understand that if somebody is denied a reservation, denied that opportunity that the Constitution's preamble speaks about, then that becomes a violation. So for that purpose, it is important that we know that it is a violation. The same with discrimination, the same with untouchability. And that is the only reason we are not getting into the whole question of reservation, because then we'll get into reservations of upper caste, reservation to backward caste, reservation to the forward communities, the 10% reservation that has been provided today. All these are matters that we can go on for hours together, based on judgments of the courts. So we are keeping away from that in order that we come clearly within the definition of human rights that we want for ourselves. The question was, if I remember, Matthew, correct me if I'm wrong, all our documents, all our official documents, we are asked to mention our caste. And I can understand the moral strength with which this question is asked. This is not asked by a mischievous participant. It is asked by a participant who has perhaps, and I'm just reading, who has perhaps, and many of you that way, a very in-depth moral position saying, I do not belong to a caste. And I will refrain from identifying with any caste. Anybody ask me which caste you belong to, I will say, I don't belong to a caste. I'm sure there are many of you in this audience who believe in that. Many people used to come and ask me, what caste do you belong to? And I used to tell them, I don't belong to a caste. And people could never believe that I said didn't belong to a caste. I didn't belong to a caste for the reason I told you earlier. I don't have a caste because I am adopted. And I'm adopted from the moment my biological mother gave birth to me. My adopted mother was the one who was attending to my birth. She did not bother to find out what caste my biological mother belonged to, and therefore, from that day onwards, I never bothered, and even today I will never. And identify with everybody. But there are people who have actually been born into a caste. They know their caste, but they believe in being people without caste, and therefore they say no caste, and they are much, much more honorable. That's a different class of people altogether. The government requires us to provide, and I'm happy, and you're going to get angry with me for me saying this, and I'm happy that the caste of people are taken down officially. Because only then we will know what pro-country. Only then we will know whether our reservations have actually benefited or not. Only then we will know whether our equality has actually been effective or not. Only if I know whether I'm a person with disabilities will I know whether the persons with disabilities have been given opportunities or not. I'm taking a very convenient example. Purposely picking that. Only if I'm marking myself as a member of the transgender community, will then the government be able to say, yes, we have so many transgenders today. Today, when the figures of the corona deaths in Tamil Nadu are mentioned every day, they mention men, the women, and then transgenders. It has come as a practice. And therefore, it is important that we identify whether you want yourself to be identified as a man or a woman or a transgender. The same way, and for that same purpose, it is important that we identify our caste. Same purpose. Now, you might be a person who doesn't want to write what caste you belong to. Say no caste. And there cannot be anybody who will pressurize you to state that you have no caste. But because you mentioned that there is no caste, you will not have opportunity to reservation. And that's fine with you. Because you take that decision with knowing exactly what are the consequences of that decision. And therefore, demanding the caste, the religion, etc. in official documents is supposed to be for this purpose. Now, this doesn't justify in any way that the class attendance register is written in a manner where your caste is demanded. I'm getting advice what not to do and what to do. Thank you. Thank you, Matthew. Thank you very much. Or Rajiv. So what is important is to ensure that these are recorded in the registers of the institution But this is not the basis on which a lecturer comes into class and says, all those students receiving scholarship, please stand up. And thus identifies who people are. I think this is something that we should ensure that is not followed at all. So, should caste be mentioned? Should religion be mentioned? Yes, definitely it should be mentioned. Where should it be mentioned? In the core register of your institution for the purposes of disaggregated data on the basis of caste, on the basis of religion that we want. And when you ask for religion, also ask for people who don't believe in religions. There are people who don't believe in religion and they say, I'm not a believer. And be happy that you have people who are not believers instead of having people who claim they are believers and commit all the frauds on earth as possible. So this is the way I would look at this whole question. It's a very moral question. Why should I write, sir, when I get into the first standard or KG or whatever it is? There itself they ask me for my caste. Say no caste. Let the father believes that there is no caste, let him also record that, or the mother record that for her daughter or son. So that's the way I would look into it. On the question of this political rights, all people are equal before the law. But in terms of sentencing, some people are given heavier sentences and some people are not. And this is very tactically brought in the context of our seven Tamils case. Friends, what you have said is true. The rich are treated differently. The poor are treated differently in sentencing. This is a fact of life. There are very few judges who are able not to see class, not to see caste. You should be present in the National Judicial Academy when judges of the Supreme Court and judges of the High Court participate in discussions on caste. You have an expert coming here, Mr. Ramesh Nathan. He handles classes for judges in the National Judicial Academy. Please ask him this question. How do judges react to the SCST Atrocities Act, those who are in the Supreme Court and those who are in the High Court? What are the type of questions they ask you? Friends, for the sake of this lecture, let me tell you, caste has a role to play in judiciary. Caste has a role to play in the investigation wings of our police department. This is a fact of life. And if we need to get over this, it is a whole movement against discrimination, caste system itself, and the practice of untouchability that we need to get in. So, coming back to this judgment, here it is more the political aspects, political angle of who these seven persons are about whom you are talking here. And therefore, definitely there is definitely discrimination. There is definitely a political role. There is definitely a role in the delay process that is taking place. All that is a fact of life. I think we have cleared the questions here. We will now move to looking at dignity. It is getting time also. I'm supposed to once again share. So we had finished looking at the right to life. We had finished looking at the right to liberty. We had finished looking at the right to equality. Now we are going to the whole question of the dignity of the individual. Friends, it's important for us to note that the Supreme Court of India, first, every violation of right to life, every violation of right to equality, every violation of the right to equality, of liberty, are all violations of right to dignity. Let us get that first. Give me 1 second. You have come for this, no? You are reporting, na? Or reporting, no? Connect, Hajisan, paranga. So every time your right to life is denied, every time somebody is without food, denial of right to food is a denial of right to life. Every time somebody is homeless, right to shelter is a part of right to life. Every time somebody is tortured, whether in the classroom or in the bedroom or on the street by a policeman, when the torture takes place, when you are shelterless, when you are hungry, at every time your dignity is also denied. When each of us are taken to the police station and the constable there or the inspector there shouts at us, whether you are a woman or a man, it is almost as if your pants are down or your sari is off, because that is the loss of dignity that each one of us suffer from. So right to life is always accompanied by the loss of dignity. The right to equality, when I am told at my face that I will never get this job because I am a born Dalit, it is not only the right to equality I suffer, but it is also that I suffer from the right to a loss of dignity as an individual. The same is in terms of right to, I'm sorry for this disturbance. This is trying to get access to the courts. We are all have to get on to the, to just as you all got into Zoom to get into this classroom, we have to get into another web for the 10:30 hearings. So my colleague has come here to take and ensure that we are also online there. So loss of right to life means loss of dignity. Loss of right to equality means also loss of dignity. Loss of freedom also means loss of dignity. This is right to dignity is a part of your violation of right to life, part of your violation of right to equality, part of your violation of right to liberty. The Supreme Court in Air India versus Nag has held that the right to human dignity implied equal respect for every person as a human being. And we can go on. The state must provide means to citizens to live a life of dignity, a life worth living. Failure of the state to provide such a life negates Article 21 of the Constitution, right to life. This is what we have to see in our judgments. Various judgments have said various things. I will read this part of it. Every act which offends against or impairs human dignity would by itself constitute deprivation of this right to life. In another case, this was in a case where a PIL was filed against a gang rape on Bangladesh women by employees of the railways in the Yatri Nivas of Howrah station of the Eastern Railway in West Bengal. The court further held in that the right to life with dignity will be available not only to every citizen, but also to every person. So it's important, friends, very, very important to know that the right to life in this country is not only for citizens. Read Article 21. Please go to Article 21. Article 21 starts with these words. Person shall be deprived of his life or personal liberty. Article 21 does not say no citizen. And therefore, this right to life that we have spoken of yesterday, we are referring today, is applicable to Sri Lankan refugees from Jaffna who are sitting here in our Sri Lankan camps. In Sri Lankan refugee camps, as they are called. They have a right to life. The Rohingyas who are here in our country, who are called by different names today, are persons living in our country. They are not citizens, but they are persons. And as long as they are persons, they have a right to life that our constitution has provided us. It's very, very important to understand that the right to life is specifically for persons. The same way right to equality. Article 14 of our constitution says, the state shall not deny to any person any person equality before the law. So our right to equality and our right to right to life in our country is not only for citizens, it is for all persons. When you come to the whole citizenship argument or the Citizenship Amendment Act discussions, all this will be clarified. But it's important to know that this dignity, therefore, is a dignity which is available to all persons as well. Thus, even those who are not citizens of this country and come here merely as tourists and come here as criminals, as come here as foreigners, come here without a passport, have overstayed on their visas or in any other capacity, will be entitled to the protection of their lives in accordance with the constitutional provisions. See the sanctity to the right to life and to right equality that our constitution provides. That is the sanctity, that is the nobleness of our constitution makers. Everybody in this country has to enjoy right to life. Every person in this country has to enjoy right to life and right to equality. Friends, in our human rights definition, let us not forget this. Right to life, right to equality, right to liberty, and right to dignity. But this is entitled to all persons, and therefore right to life and equality being to all persons, and dignity also being to all persons, most part of our human rights violations are for everybody on this, everybody on this soil. You have other cases which the famous cases of the Bonded Labor Liberation Front, which is the Bandhua Mukti Morcha led by Swami Agnivesh versus the Union of India in 1984. The Supreme Court held, just listen to this and think of our time. This right to live with human dignity enshrined in Article 21 derives its life breath from the directive principles of state policy. So fundamental right derives its strength from the directive principles of state policy. Particularly clauses E and F of Article 39 and Articles 41 and 42. Therefore, include health. This is where they say, therefore, it should include protection of health and strength of workers, men and women, and of the tender age of children against abuse, opportunities and facilities for children to develop in a healthy manner and in condition of freedom and dignity, educational facilities, just and humane conditions of work and maternity relief. All this is part of the life with human dignity. That is the whole question of how dignity is being looked at. So friends, on the last years, this has to be mentioned. In the year 1997, Justice J.S. Verma, in his judgment in the Vishakha versus State of Rajasthan case, interpreted gender equality of women. And this is the mother judgment of the Supreme Court. I told you every law of the Supreme Court, every judgment of the Supreme Court is equivalent to law. And therefore, this judgment in Vishakha versus State of Rajasthan in the year 1997 was the basic case for later the Sexual Harassment in the Workplace Act that came up in the year 2013. And he said that sexual harassment of women at the workplace is against their dignity. It's not only against their life, it is against their dignity. I told you, right to life always has right to dignity along with it. Here, sexual harassment of the workplace, Justice Verma says in Vishakha versus State of Rajasthan, it is against their dignity. It is also the violation of the fundamental rights in Article 19G, because they are practicing their right to practice any profession or carry out any occupation, trade or business. And if a teacher has a right to carry out, a lady teacher has a right to carry out a profession as a professor in a college, and she faces sexual harassment at the workplace in the place, then she is not only denied her right to life, she is not only denied her right to dignity, but she is also denied a right to liberty of carrying out a trade, an occupation, a profession in her college where she's working. Because at the place of employment, there is discrimination, which is on the basis of, which is a sexual harassment at the workplace. So friends, this is how you will look at dignity. We have been able to see right to life, right to liberty, equality, and the other clauses. Now, I will take two questions, and then I'll go on to the activities. Yes?
Yes. So, there are there were many questions, but was again general in nature. What I could get sense of what people wanted to ask, when there have been so many rights with regard to equality, with regard to right to life with dignity, others guaranteed by the Constitution, despite being 70 years since the adoption of the Indian Constitution, why certain things continue to be the same? That is one. Second is, with regard to your examples on Rohingya, your reference to Rohingya refugees, then one person asks, why is there so much hue and cry for Rohingyas when our constitution has guaranteed right to life for them also? So these two questions I would like to put up at this particular moment.
Okay, I will take the Rohingyas first because it is easier to answer. Whoever asked that, mark the name, because we can remind the person once again to raise this question where in the section where you look at refugee rights or human rights. And I don't want to get into it because you have an expert, Mr. Paul Newman, who will be handling it, and an expert, Mr. Paul Newman, who has visited Jaffna, my dear friends, and his PhD is about internal migration in Jaffna, displacement, internal displacement in that Jaffna Peninsula. Anyhow, so the whole question of Rohingyas, I'm just postponing. But the fact is, and we both, you, the one who asked the question, and I have to answer, yes, Rohingyas have a right to life. Rohingyas have a right to dignity. And as long as they are on Indian soil, their right to life and their right to dignity cannot be questioned. But today they are not called refugees. After the 2003 amendment to the Citizenship Act, they are no longer refugees. They are all called illegal migrants, illegal immigrants. Therefore, the Sri Lankan refugees who have come from Sri Lanka, they live in camps which say Sri Lankan refugees, but for the purpose of citizenship, they are not refugees, they are illegal immigrants. We will go more into this question later. But right now we are saying, even a Sri Lankan refugee, you and I call them refugees because we are accustomed to call them refugees, have a right to life and have a right to equality. Number two is a question which is very, very important, which you asked, number one. And I'm happy people asked it. I thought by now you'll be wild. You have every right to be wild. Why are all these violations of right to life taking place? And why are our courts insensitive to these violations? Largely insensitive. Let me be a little careful, because there are very sensitive judges as well. But it is not that they always get posted on benches where decisions can be made. We spoke about Justice Deepak Gupta. Go and see how many benches of the Supreme Court Justice Deepak Gupta was posted on. You will understand why this Justice Deepak Gupta only could speak on the day of his retirement in his farewell function. If he was put in a position where he could take a decision and he refused to take a decision, that is different. But if he is always put in positions on benches where there are not very important issues of human rights to speak about, then it is difficult for the judge to express himself and his beliefs. And I won't say anything more, and I won't make references to other judges. So, after so many years, 70 years, what has happened? Not only have courts remained silent, our legal services authorities have remained silent. Our legal services authorities, which are supposed to function, which are supposed to look after the poor, the scheduled castes, the women, the children, the incarcerated, those in custody, labor, those who suffer from natural disasters, the legal aid should spontaneously go and take up their cause. The legal aid was under lockdown in Tamil Nadu and many other states during this lockdown period of 50 days. So friends, human rights are not only to be covered in a certificate course. As you say, it is time after 70 years of seeing this nonsense that you and I both together will say we express solidarity. We will work together. We'll work together on different platforms to ensure that you and I are able to take this movement of for protection and promotion of human rights forward. You can't do it alone. I can't do it alone. But when you and I join together, many of us join together for the protection and promotion of human rights, we become different personalities who are now called human rights defenders. And as human rights defenders, a terminology of the United Nations, you being a student or you being a professor or you being a lawyer or you being a professor of law or a doctor, you and I are equal because we are human rights defenders, and we will ensure that we carry on our duty of protecting and promoting human rights as a human rights defender. Yes, as much as you are agitated, I am agitated. But being agitated alone does not matter. But being agitated is what is going to first matter. And I'm happy that you are agitated. I'm so happy, Matthew, that many of them ask these disgusting question. Because that disgusting question is what is never answered. It never answered on our campuses. It never answered in our institutions. Never answered on the streets. But we have to ensure that we raise them. I can tell you, friends, many people think that I disturb peace a lot. Yes, I disturb peace. I disturb the peace of several people. But I can tell you, I try my best. And these are not said out of pride. We say it out of humility. I always have one thing in mind. Be humble as a human rights activist. Be loud. Be clear. Talk at the top of your voice. But always with dignity and respect to the individual. And therefore, today I have a DGP in my state, a DGP who is ruling the state, with whom I have fought. I have a colleague in my office who is working, who is a social worker, whose father was killed in custody in the year on 2nd August 1998 in the city of Madurai. My DGP, my good friend, Tripathi, was the SP here. This father was tortured. Tied in the Umachukulam police station upside down, beaten, nails in finger. His mother, my colleagues, the one who died, Guruvaya, his wife, was raped in custody. Doesn't mean Tripathi and we are not good friends. I fight with Mr. Tripathi. I fight with him. But my respect for him will continue. But when we have to fight, we will fight. I have the Chief Secretary of Tamil Nadu, same way. Very nice gentleman, Mr. Shanmugam, who was responsible for introducing human rights education in all the schools in Tamil Nadu, from where it went like fire to all other states. All the policemen with whom I fight. If I don't fight with a policeman, then I have nothing with them. But if I fight with a policeman, that means I have the greatest regard for them. Fighting for rights does not mean we are arrogant. Fighting for rights does not mean we are disrespectful. Fighting for rights only means we uphold the greatest dignity to this constitution. And greatest dignity, and we are also performing our fundamental duties under Article 51A of the Constitution. Friends, this course has to teach you and me that. Every time I teach you that, I gain strength, because I gain strength from all the 191 participants here. You are passing on strength to me. Don't go and say, Henry spoke very well. Henry spoke because of the strength that you provided me. That is where solidarity is built. That is where the engagement starts. And that is where the protest starts. Let us be people who believe that to be a good Indian citizen, I have to perform my fundamental duties under 51A of the Constitution, read it, and then live by it by actively protesting. Friends, as much as I would like to continue, I will go to two activities. Many people were very upset that I did not talk about activities yesterday. When we gave activities, people said, oh my goodness. Now when activities were not given, people said, oh, no activities. So here is an activity for you all. This activity will come in detail. I've just 2 minutes more. Therefore, I will not allow anybody to intervene. And the activity is this. Have a sheet of paper. On one side, on the left, put UDA, Universal Declaration of Human Rights. On the right hand side, write Indian Constitution, Fundamental Rights and Directive Principles of State Policy, Part 3 and Part 4. Google and keep the Constitution in front of you. Left hand side, Universal Declaration of Human Rights, Article 1 to 30. Put 30 lines, Article 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, up to 30. Now read the Constitution's fundamental rights, read the Constitution's directive principles of state policy, and match Article 1 of the UDHR with what are the provisions, relevant provisions of the Constitution of India. Sometimes one provision will be there, sometimes two provisions might apply, sometimes three provisions will apply. Article 1 to 30, match them with the Constitution of India, Part 3 of the Constitution of India. And Part 4 of the Constitution of India, Fundamental Rights and Directive Principles of State Policy. That's activity 2. And at the end, mention what your observations are. When you did this exercise, at the end, what were your observations? You know that the Constitution came in a particular year. You know that the UDHR came in a particular year. Look at your exercise and point out what your observations are at the end. Bullet points, one observation, two observation, that's all. I don't want essays. Very simple, table with observations. Next exercise, next activity. I told you we will go on giving you activities. Lecturers don't like activities, but lecturers like giving activities. And for these activities are for you to give students. But if you don't do the activity, you don't know what to do. So when you have time, at least read the activity and try to do it. Select any right. Match against each of the rights selected the normal violations that are known to you of that particular right. Put right to life. And in your own words, no legal words, your own words, what are the violations of that right to life that you see every day that are known to you? Put right to equality, what are the violations? Right to liberty, what are the violations? Right to dignity, what are the violations? What are the violations of life, liberty, equality, and dignity? 5 violations, 10 violations, no problem. I've given you an example. Right to life, corporal punishment in schools, domestic violence at home, police torture in the police station, eviction of the poor from their habitations during evictions, etc. These are the type of violations that we normally have. So friends, it's important to ensure that these activities are carried out. We shall close. It is nearing 10:15. 10:15, I will close. I hope you will be able to do these activities. This evening at 5:30, once the class is over, all of you will be convened by your respective facilitators on respective modes of communication that they would like to use. Some may like to convene this meeting of your group on Jitsi. Some may like to do it on Zoom. Please don't do it on a conference call alone. Let us have a little more opportunity of a platform like this. There was a student who gave me a feedback yesterday. A proud student for me, because her father was a proud student of mine, who is a powerful lawyer today, a famous human rights lawyer in the city of Tuticorin. Angeline told me yesterday, "Madam, I am a member of the group where Professor Uma Maheshwari is the facilitator. Can we have the Google classroom?" I said, "Madam, you are the teacher. The younger generation are the teachers. So if you are accustomed to Google classroom, tell your facilitator to use Google classroom. Most probably your facilitators may not know Google classroom. Your teacher will, Uma Maheshwari will definitely know. If I was sitting there, I may not know. And therefore, let the participants also participate in what should be the medium, whether it should be Jitsi, whether it should be Google Classroom, whether it should be Zoom or something else, and then have a good communication for 15 minutes where you will review the course and where you will see how the activities have been carried out, what are the difficulties, and what is the program for tomorrow. Friends, it is 10:15. I promised you I will leave you at 10:15. All the best and have a good morning. I hope this was good. Our right to life, our right to equality, our liberty and dignity of individuals have to be protected. And only if we protect these rights, we are protecting human rights in this country. Thank you. All the best. We close with this, and then we will open again this afternoon for the next lecture with Professor Parivelan at 4 o'clock. You will check in at 3:45. Thank you. See you again. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Matthew, I'm leaving.
Yeah. Talk to you later. Bye.
Come on. Now, Andre.